People who are concerned with computer security are sometimes interested in what's called data oblivious algorithms. A data oblivious algorithm has an interesting property, which is that the memory access pattern of that algorithm will be the same for all inputs of the same size. Usually, for an algorithm, the memory access pattern of that algorithm might depend on the data contained in the input. The problem in computer security is that an eavesdropper might be able to observe the memory access pattern of the algorithm. So an eavesdropper might be able to observe that at a specific time we asked for access to some specific memory address, and then after that we asked for access to some other memory address, and then we wrote to some third address, and then we read the second address again, and so on. And this can reveal some information. For example, in cryptography, you might be able to deduce some facts about a cryptographic key just by observing those memory access patterns. But if your algorithm is data oblivious, then the memory access pattern will always be the same, no matter what the actual bits in the input are. And for that reason, just by observing the memory access pattern, you cannot learn anything about the input. So this can be a useful security measure. For Turing machines, we can define something quite similar, and we call this an oblivious Turing machine. An oblivious Turing machine has the property that the head movements of the Turing machine do not depend on the input, but only on the length of the input. It turns out that an oblivious Turing machine can simulate a standard Turing machine with only a polynomial slowdown. Specifically, for any Turing machine M that decides a language in time Tm of n, where n is the size of the input, there exists an oblivious Turing machine that decides the same language in time O of Tm of n squared. Very roughly, the idea for the simulation is as follows. We look at the running time of the Turing machine M, and that gives us a range on the tape that will be used. So the Turing machine that has running time Tm of n will never be able to visit any cell that is further than Tm of n many positions away from the starting position. So there's a leftmost point of the tape that we could visit, and a rightmost point of the tape that we could visit. The idea behind the oblivious Turing machine is that the oblivious Turing machine simply moves back and forth between the leftmost endpoint and this rightmost endpoint. So it just moves from the leftmost endpoint to the rightmost endpoint and back. That's the entire movement of the Turing machine, and we'll just repeat doing this the entire time. And so clearly this is oblivious, because the head movement doesn't depend on the contents of the tape at all. In order to still be able to perform the computation, the Turing machine will place markers, extra markers, in certain cell positions. Specifically, the Turing machine will mark the position at which the head really should be. So our oblivious Turing machine will mark the position at which the Turing machine M currently has its head. And when we pass from, say, left to right over the tape, at some point we will encounter the cell of the tape that contains the marker. And that means we now happen to be in the correct position. And we can perform whatever computational step the machine M would have done at this point. And then once we've done that, we pass further down, further to the right end, without really doing anything. Okay, so that's the rough idea. More specifically, we do the following. For each cell in the tape, we store not only a symbol of the alphabet, but also some extra symbols. And we allow the following three extra symbols. The first one is a symbol L, which marks the leftmost endpoint of the tape that we are interested in at this point in time. And the other marker is R, which marks the rightmost endpoint of the tape that we are interested in at this point. And then an additional marker is H, which marks the head position of the Turing machine M at the current simulation step. We achieve that we can store this additional information in the tape by increasing the size of the tape alphabet. So we augment the tape alphabet so that we have space for those extra symbols to be stored alongside the symbols that we would have to store anyway. When we start our simulation initially, we just place the marker L and R at the starting position of the head. Because we know that the Turing machine M cannot have traveled anywhere so far, and therefore this is the only cell that is interesting right now. And then after that, what we will do is in each step of the simulation, so when the Turing machine M performs a single step, we will move the marker L and the marker R one cell to the left and one cell to the right, respectively. And so this ensures that the head position of the Turing machine M is always in between those two markers. To simulate a single step, we will now do the following. We move from the leftmost marker to the rightmost marker until we encounter the marker H. At this point, we read what original symbol there is on the tape at this position, because that is what the Turing machine M would read in this step. We look up in the transition function what the internal state and this symbol we just read tells us to do. We write a new symbol according to what the transition function says. We switch our internal state. And finally, we have to move the head position. Either it stays where it is, or it moves one position to the right, or one position to the left. So the movement of the head is a bit tricky. What we have to do is, if we want to move the head position one cell to the right, we would have to erase the marker at the current position and then write it in the cell right next to it. So this is the easy part because we are moving in that direction anyway. Remember, we are moving from the leftmost marker to the rightmost marker. So we just erase the H at the current position, move one cell to the right, which we would have done anyway, and then place the H there. If we have to move the head to the left, it's a bit more complicated because we cannot simply erase the marker H in the current cell, then move one cell to the left and write an H there. The reason why we cannot do this is because this would break the oblivious property of the Turing machine we want to construct. The Turing machine should only move to the right until it reaches the rightmost end marker and then move all the way back. So what we do instead is we go all the way to the right until the rightmost marker, and then on the way back, once we encounter H, we are moving in the right direction now. So we can erase H, move one cell to the left, and write an H there. And so that's the entire idea behind this simulation.